Good evening, everybody, and welcome to the spookiest episode of Square Roots of the Year! Mwah! 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 I'm Vanessa, and I'm joined by John of the Dead, Brandon.
I'm so scared!
And Jim, run on the banks!
Ooh.
Nothing's scarier than a run on the banks. Just ask George Bailey and that old savings and loan.
I threw the map in the river, Vanessa.
Oh.
Threw the map in the river.
Oh, John.
Mm-hmm.
Well,
you'll never get out of this spooky forest.
Oh, man. Now we're stuck in the spooky forest. Well, what can be done?
Let's make a podcast while we're
here. Let's make a podcast in this creaky forest. Hoot hoot, owl, hoot hoot. Twink snap, twink snap.
Is this a bag of teeth?
Yeah, there's a little baggie of teeth, but it's like a Ziploc, so they're nice and fresh.
Oh, okay.
We have a crackling campfire going.
I've got a ghost story for everybody,
but
I think we can all help tell it.
Oh, is this the true story of what happened to our friends?
Is this the one about the sexy teens in the mountain lodge?
Yeah, Our good friends at the mountain lodge.
It's a Canadian story that features Americans who visited Canada and lived to regret.
Are they in Canada?
Or did they?
Oh, yeah. I didn't know that.
Oh, I didn't realize.
You didn't notice all the stuff about the Mounties or the Alberta papers how the government signs were in English and French?
Nope.
Nope.
But the French was weird and not great?
No, I did not. Well... Listeners, we hope that you can stay with us all night until dawn. We played Until Dawn from Supermassive Games.
Ooh, I don't know. What else have they done?
I don't know, but it was probably pretty
They've
big.
Done some VR stuff. They did an Until Dawn prequel called The Inpatient. And
ooh, taking place in that spooky asylum.
And they've done, I think, like some other VR horror themed carnival deal. And I think it's mostly VR stuff.
Apparently, they are known for the side-scrolling action game, Doctor Who. Doctor Who, The Eternity Clock.
I don't know that one.
Nor do I.
Oh, I guess they did Little Big Planet 2.
What?
Some Little Big Planet stuff. And The Inpatient, which was the Until Dawn offshoot. Something called The Hidden Agenda, which I think is like a PS4 party game, maybe.
Oh, I've heard about that one.
And they have some other VR stuff coming out. Something called Bravo Team this year, and then another game called The Dark Pictures Anthology Men of Medan next year.
Yeah, that sounds lame.
So, this is like it's a lot like a Quantic Dream game. It's a lot like a Heavy Rain or Beyond Two Souls.
Uh-huh, uh-huh.
Or I assume a Detroit, or a Walking Dead by Telltale.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Except it stars even more of everybody's favorite actors. And I guess we can talk about them as we talk about our cast of characters.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Ooh.
So let's set the scene.
Mm-hmm.
We open in Canada, apparently. High up on Blackwood Mountain.
I thought it was Mount Washington.
It's Washington Law, John Blackwood Mountain. Yeah,
the family that owns that's it right. is the Washingtons.
Yes.
Okay, that's why it's the Washington. Okay.
And only the Washington children are present. Josh Washington and his twin sisters, Hannah and Beth Washington.
The game kind of opens like a lot of slasher movies do, with teens playing a prank on another teen, another vulnerable teen.
Yeah.
How far into this game do these teens stop playing pranks? Because it seems like
I think they're playing pranks till the very end, depending on how you play it. they're pranking some monsters is what they end up doing.
Spoiler alert.
My.
Yeah, sorry. So we don't know anything about monsters or creepiness. We only know about Hannah, who is in love with Dreamy Mike.
Who is played by an actor named Brett Dalton, who was in some Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. episodes, I think.
Yeah, he was Agent Ward. Yeah, the first season. He came back after the first season, too. The first season, his character was terrible, and then it got very interesting. And then he left the show.
Oh, interesting. And there's also Hayden Panettiere, who was, I think, the cheerleader?
Yeah, she is the cheerleader who one must save.
Okay, but she's not there yet. She comes in a second.
Right.
Well, no, they're all there in the beginning. Mike...
They're all in the house, but they're not. Oh,
they're
all in
the room and
they're
about to hide, right?
She's downstairs or taking a shower or something.
Right. But the other ones are like, let's hide because they're going to do this prank.
Yes, most of them are there. And we should just kind of go through what we have. We have Dreamy Mike, who is the jock.
Mm-hmm. Well, see, he's not the jock. I'd say Matt's more of a jock than Mike.
That's true.
I guess Mike's just like the guy. Then.
Mike is like the handsome, witty, cut-up guy.
Is he witty?
His jokes are lame, but he's, he's like, he tries. He's like the handsome, goofy guy.
Right. So we have handsome, goofy Mike. We have Sam, who is Hayden...
Panettiere.
And she is athletic and nice.
Mm-hmm. And she's like the smart, wry girl who's not bitchy.
Yeah,
she's not bitchy. We have, we talked about Hannah and Beth. Neither of them have any particular personality.
Yeah, none that you really, well, no, that's not true. Hannah's like a shy nerd.
Hannah's a shy nerd. And their personality is twins.
Yeah, she's a shy nerd, but she's, I mean, in the context of this video game, is a sexy nerd.
Mm-hmm.
Really?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
Oh, she's definitely, I mean.
Okay.
And they were both played by an actress named Ella Lentini. Who you may know from, I don't know, something. Looking at it, she, I don't know, she was on Law and Order. She's been on a whole bunch of TV shows. She's a working actress.
She's a character actor.
She's a character actor. Who else do we have? We have Josh, played by the titular Mr. Robot, Rami Malek. Please don't write in and tell me that he is not the titular Mr. Robot. I know that.
Throughout this whole first couple of chapters, he just has crazy face. Like, he's always looking insane.
I couldn't tell. It took a while for me to be like, is that just weird motion capture, or is that just his weird face?
Well, he's got that thing. There's a term for it, and I can't remember. Like, if you see the white of your eye under your eye, people assume you're crazy. Like, it's one of those ways.
Oh, interesting.
It's associated with it, even if it's not true, because we know plenty of people who have that, and it doesn't make it crazy. It's just, but that's something that I think they accentuate in this game, that you always see the whites under his eyes. And, okay, we'll introduce people sort of, like, right now, There's just a bunch of teens in this, and they're planning a prank.
Yeah, mm-hmm. So they kind of plant a letter in the kitchen from Mike to Hannah. Now, Mike is dating Emily in this portion of the game. So, but he leaves a note for Hannah, who is enamored with him, and says, "Meet me in this bedroom in like 15 minutes." But what she doesn't know is that they're planning like an elaborate prank where they're going to videotape her like taking her clothes off, which is terrible.
Yeah, it's like not it's great. Not so much a prank as like mild sexual assault.
Yeah. And so, I mean, that's kind of what happened. She goes up there and she's, you know, she's really happy and she's going to like take her shirt off. And then everybody busts out and they're like, "Oh, surprise." And then,
and everyone's in there except for her brother and sister. Her brother is passed out drunk. Mm-hmm. And I guess one of the other guys is with him. Chris is also drunk.
Yeah, I think Chris is in the kitchen. Mm-hmm. And Sam is not there either.
Yeah, Sam's like taking a shower or something. And so, they all jump out at her and they're like, "Haha, you're dumb to think that a man would be interested in you because you are very conventionally attractive."
Yeah, even though you're like 5'9", brunette.
Yeah. And beautiful.
And beautiful.
You suck. So Hannah runs away. She runs like straight out into the night, into the snowy woods. And then her sister goes too, because she's like, "You guys suck. What did you do to my sister?" And we play as the sister Beth in this little portion. Interesting fact about this game, we play as many different people throughout it.
I think we get a turn as every character.
Just about every one of these cool teens, for sure.
I think, I mean, with the exception of Hannah and Beth. Or, well, no, we play as Beth, with the exception of Hannah, I think we play as every teen.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So they run out. They hear some noises in the woods and run away. And they go and they're, like, cornered by a cliff. Hannah falls off, and she is holding Beth's hand, and Beth falls off too, but Beth grabs a branch, and they're both hanging there, and a figure appears and is extending a hand to help them, but...
And it's wearing a spooky mask.
It's wearing a spooky mask, and you don't know who this spooky figure is. I believe you have the choice to either drop
Hannah...
Or just drop yourself. Yeah.
What did you all do?
I believe that I just let go.
I definitely just let go.
Yeah, I didn't trust the dude. I didn't want to let Hannah.
You're just gonna like drop your plan. Come on. Besides,
and this is
like
where you find out
snowy. They'll land on some soft snow. It'll be great.
This is where you find out the game does not pull punches when it comes to gore and injury.
Yeah,
no, we are treated to the twins tumbling down a hill and rolling to camera, one of them, and coming to a dead stop with a glossy dead eyes.
And the other one, her back like lands on a rock.
Yeah, she lands flat on a rock on her back. You can hear it like crack.
Yeah.
Yeah, there is a for sure. Crunch.
Oh, and as you're playing as Beth looking for Hannah, you're introduced to the mechanic in this game of finding collectibles. So when you're playing as Beth, you find your first totem, which as you pick up totems, there are three different kinds. There's a fortune totem, a death totem, and a danger totem. And wait, maybe there's one other one, a fortune totem. Lost totem.
There's loss.
And as you pick these totems up, they give you glimpses of the future.
And this one
shows I think one of the twins falling off and like breaking their back on the rock.
Yeah, that's it. Shows Beth dying.
Yeah.
I think.
Yeah.
So that's what happens. They're both seemingly dead. Then flash forward to a year later, all of the teens are having a reunion back at the lodge at the behest of Josh, the twins' brother.
Mm-hmm.
Would you have done this?
Would I?
Would you have
gone to a reunion of the place where my friends went missing a year ago?
Yes.
Probably not.
Yeah, I mean, I can understand being good friends with Josh, but this seems like a weird thing.
I mean, but his message...
They all sort of talk about how Josh is, like, not doing that great.
Yeah, and in his message, he's like, hey, it means a lot that you guys are coming back, and it's been a tough year, and I'm really glad to be able to hang out with friends again. So, I mean, I can see why they come back.
And we get a nice little opening credit scene with a jingly song about death.
Yeah, I was like, death, oh death.
Oh death, oh death.
But there's also news, like cuts of radio snippets about the girls being dead or missing for 1 year.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Presumed
And also
dead.
They say that the mountain has like a troubled history, that the Washingtons were being like accosted by a guy that nobody knows who he is, who lives on the mountain and says the mountain is his, and apparently there's some other sordid history back in the 50s that happened on the mountain that they don't talk about directly here, but you learn a lot about as the story progresses.
And finding all the backstory out stuff, I think, is my favorite part of the game and is really good. Like, I love learning about... I think I like spooky haunted house games more than I like murder games.
Yes.
Like, I wish it, like there's one section, we'll talk more about it when we get there, but there's one section where you're exploring the asylum that I just thought was super cool because it wasn't super scary and it was like, it was gory and weird and fun. And I wish more of the game was like that because I can't handle the scares. Like, it took me several tries to get through the first three chapters because I was just too scared to play.
Wow.
There's a lot of jump scares in this game, and I just can't handle them. Like, I get too freaked out, and I find it unpleasant. So I had to get further in the game. I had to have a few beers, which dulled down my sense of anxiety. Trying to play
That's
through
what
this.
Happens to these
probably
teens.
Also, your reaction time.
Well, but I didn't. I think I got one quick time event wrong.
Mm-hmm.
So I was pretty good. But I made some mistakes, which we'll get
to.
Yeah.
So the friends, and it's worth noting, we'll just tell the listeners at this point, you can end this game with all of the teens alive, none of the teens alive, or somewhere in between. Mm-hmm. Or should I say in between?
No, you should not.
With the exception of Hannah and Beth, who are just... prologue teens, and they do not count.
Yeah.
Okay.
So the whole gang loads up onto like a ski lift that takes them up to the lodge.
I really like the introduction of the characters as they kind of trickle in, and I like that they kind of laid out the foundations of the relationship as you're introduced to them.
Mm-hmm.
So really the only things that matter here in terms of like relationship stuff that you can like build on is Chris, who is like the nerdy jokester teen.
Mm-hmm. He's a total nerd boy.
Is best buds with Ashley, and they have kind of like an unrequited romance. And
because he has a thing for Sam,
and you know that and they tell you that Mike and Emily are broken up. Emily is with Matt and Mike is with Jessica.
And Matt and Jessica were not at the lodge last time, right?
Yeah.
They're brand new.
Oh boy.
So we have a fun little practice quick time with Mike and Jessica. They have a romantic snowball fight.
Nice, sexy snowball fight.
You can look at, as Sam, you can steal Chris's cell phone when it's like open and unlocked to take a look at it. But apparently that makes him not trust you ever again.
Yeah, it makes him angry.
Did you do it? I did not.
I respected his privacy.
Did you hit the Was it the squirrel with the snowball?
No, he finds a gun, and there's like a little shooting range, and you can shoot at stuff, and you have the option to either shoot the squirrel or not shoot the squirrel.
Yeah, I did not shoot that squirrel.
I did not shoot it either. That's bad karma.
It was interesting. I didn't do it either because I can't. Unfortunately, I think we might make a lot of the same choices here. But
that's why we need Matt to be like, I shot the squirrel.
Shoot the squirrel, nature goes out of balance, and I think you get attacked by more animals.
Yeah, and you also, speaking of Matt, Matt is not on the recording, obviously, and he didn't finish the game. He never admit it, but I think it was too scary for him.
Mm-hmm.
I just ran out of time, unfortunately, so I'm very sorry. I really tried my best, but this game's real scary, and I was real busy.
Mm-hmm.
So everybody eventually makes it to the lodge. Mm-hmm. There's a slight like kerfuffle on the way as Emily insists on going back for her bags, but she really just wants to say hi to Mike. And Matt can spy them like hugging each other through a viewfinder from like a ledge above them. And that can piss him off a little bit. And he can, like, try to fight Mike when they all get to the lodge.
I did show Matt the two of them hugging, because I was like, oh, let's be a little jerky.
So did I.
And then I sort of chose him to... I chose Matt to not be a jerk every chance I could. So like I maxed out his nice, you get stats on all the choices you're making. I maxed out his nice guy meter, but Emily still hates him.
Yeah, she's a really
Emily
rude to
hates
him.
Everyone. Why is anyone friends with Emily?
I don't know. Like every other character like has moments where you like them, even Mike, who I don't like. But Emily in particular is just, she doesn't, at least in my playthrough, never had a moment where she was nice or interesting, or she didn't save a cat, for instance.
I wish that that Jessica would have been a bigger part of the story, because she was kind of my favorite character.
Yeah, she's fun.
They kind of present her at first as kind of like the ditzy blonde a teen, but she's actually very funny and smart and like wry, and she kind of turned into my favorite character.
Yeah, she well, when you all get up to the lodge, Josh is like, hey, thanks everybody for coming, you know, it's so good to see you, I know this is kind of weird, let's all split up.
Yeah, by the way, he did nothing to prepare for their arrival. There's no electricity. Nope. The hot water isn't working. The door is still locked and frozen.
Hey, guys, I'm out of that well. That was spooky.
Congratulations.
Thank you. So where were we? We were talking about their little kerfuffle at the house.
Yeah, we're
Everyone
at the lodge.
Everyone sort of yells at each other.
Yeah.
Em and Jessica get into a fight.
Whose
well, side do you,
can,
you take?
You can avoid the cat fight.
Oh, really?
Yeah. If you're playing as Matt, you can, or if you're making a decision as Matt, there's a decision he can make that maybe it's as Mike, but you can avoid the cat fight altogether.
You don't have her bragging about her 4.0 GPA and stuff.
It totally. Oh, wow. Yeah, and then but you, I think Matt and Mike fight.
Oh man.
Yeah.
Yeah, emotions are very high because they miss their friends, and then there are these new people, and everyone's just all a fuss.
Everybody's got
so,
baggage.
Yeah. Mike and Jess decide to go off on their own to a guest cabin so they can have some sexy times.
Yeah, so the way that it splits off here is Mike and Jessica go to the guest cabin. Sam goes to take a bath in this freezing cold
Sam's just like, fuck
lodge.
This, I'm gonna go take a bath.
And then Ashley and Josh and Chris decide to play with a Ouija board, or spirit board, as they call it, because they could not afford to call it a Ouija board.
Now,
oh, and Matt and what's her name go to get her bags,
right?
Yeah. Now, you might say, what the heck are they doing having a bath at a time like this in a spooky giant lodge? And the answer is, it looks like the nicest bathtub I've ever seen, so I totally don't blame
her. It's a nice
her.
Bathtub.
It's like a raised pedestal in the middle of the bathroom. This huge bathroom. Mm-hmm. It looks steamy hot. Does she have some candles going?
Oh, yeah. She makes all the candles.
Yeah. She's like, I'm going to make the best of this. I came here just for this bathtub.
It looks pretty nice.
I will use it. I've stayed in a hotel room once where the bathtub was so nice that I took a bath every night I was there. And I am not usually a bath person, but it was great.
Yeah. No.
The Bellagio in Las Vegas, Nevada.
I lived in a house before. It didn't have a shower, but it did have a bathtub that was like a two-person bathtub. Mm-hmm. And it was amazing. Like, I'd just hang in there and read, and I never do that.
Did you have, like, one of those hose things that you put on the faucet to make it into a shower?
Well, yeah, it came with a thing. Like, it also had jets.
Oh. Well. Oh,
nice.
Yeah, that was a nice bath. Anyway. So I don't blame her for that. So Matt and M... I think M forgot her bag at the cable car station, so she goes back for that. That's why they leave. So I think you first follow Sam and Josh as they go downstairs. And they hear some spooky noises.
I thought we did Mike and Jessica first.
Oh, maybe you're right.
I think it goes Mike and Jessica first as they make their way to the guest cabin. Some creepy stuff starts happening to them. They run into a deer, and then they find the deer further down the path, and it's been mutilated.
No, no.
I didn't put it out of its misery, but I did, like, comfort it as it died.
I did. So I chose to put it out of its misery, and a hilarious thing happens where he's, like, trying to, like, put the deer in a chokehold, I guess, and he pulls its head off.
Oh, no.
Yeah, its head comes off.
God.
I imagine that Jess was not feeling very amorous after that.
Well, right after the head comes off, the body gets, like, pulled into the woods.
Well, same with if you comfort it to death, too.
Comfort it to death.
Was this before or after Jess pulls a prank? Because I think the end of the chapter is Jess, like, disappears and starts screaming, but it's a prank. And the prank is that she, like, is laughing at him. Or something.
Oh, yeah, so she...
Yeah, for, like, being afraid for her.
Well, they have to climb over a big log, and then, so she's like, I'm gonna climb over it, and she makes it to the top, and then, like, totally smokes him in the head with a snowball, and then he looks away and looks up, and she's gone.
Yeah.
And then, so actually the game cuts
and
there, and then
screaming.
goes back to Josh and Sam trying to turn the boiler on.
I was trying to figure out what she did in the meantime. We'll just get this a little out of order. I think after she disappeared screaming and he hustles up the log after her, she puts a mask in a car window to scare Mike. Is that what happens? Because there's a mask set up to scare
him. I didn't understand
him.
That. Like, whose truck was that and why was there a scary mask that was on, like, a spring?
Yeah, I don't know. That was weird.
Well, there's some hardcore pranking going on for sure.
There's also, like, this weird night vision of them walking and, like, they're glowing white and everything else is red.
Sort of implying that someone is watching them.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. You get, like, monster cam. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
They get to their little cabin, right? And I think that someone said, depending on how you play this. Oh, it was you, John. You were talking about undressing her versus not, right?
Depending on, like, how nice to her you are, you can, she will either keep her shirt on or take her shirt off and be in a bra.
Okay.
Like real life.
Mm-hmm.
He takes his shirt off either way, right?
He does. Well, yeah, but he's wearing like an undershirt.
Yeah. Okay, she doesn't... I didn't get her down to a bra. I think
I didn't either.
But
I just had her down to, like, a t-shirt.
Off. Yeah. But I wasn't heroic. Oh, yeah, because on the way, you can be heroic to her. Because you go you take a shortcut through a spooky mine. And I was, like, telling her to, like, do stuff on her own. And she couldn't. And eventually I came down. And that's what pissed her off. So I think if you, like, do the heroic thing immediately, you can get snuggly time with her.
Ooh. Mm-hmm. But not for long. Because no. She jumps out a window.
Yeah, no, well, she freaks out when you first get to the cabin because she lost her phone while you guys were running away from the thing that sucked the deer carcass into the woods. Mm-hmm. And when, so she's kind of pissed off because she loses her phone. And then right as they start making out and start getting sexual, you hear a glass break. And Mike goes into the bedroom and something had thrown her phone into the house.
Mm-hmm.
And as they're freaking out about it, because she runs out to the porch because she assumes they're playing a prank on her. And yeah. Yells out into the wilderness, "You can't ruin our night. We're going to fuck." And then she closes the door and then she gets sucked out the window.
Yeah.
Yeah. That- but Mike goes running after.
Yeah, he does. He grabs the gun and just takes off after her.
He grabs the gun and a gas lamp.
He does. Yeah, he grabs a lamp too.
Yeah.
And then there's a lot of decisions to make here and a lot of quick time events because you can shortcut it or you can take the safe route. I shortcutted it.
Yeah, there's basically a timer here. So the shorter amount of time it takes you to get to her, the more likely it is she'll be okay.
Yeah, and I think like this is also dependent on your decisions towards her too, because when you do find her and you find her in a mine, and she's scratched up, I think if you treated her badly, she can be dead here.
Oh.
But if you treat her well enough, she's seemingly still alive, but then the elevator that she's down. Like resting on, like falls down into the shaft and she's on it, and then Mike just, I guess, assumes she's dead.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And Mike sees like a figure because he looks up the shaft and there's like a little face looking at him and he tries to shoot it.
Mm-hmm. Now that didn't happen to me. I didn't get to shoot. Oh, no, I did. You're right.
He looks through the scope of the gun.
The first time I played this game, this is like right about where I got to in 2015. I got to the mine. I was getting to the mine shaft, but I kept hitting wrong buttons on the way down, and he kept stumbling and getting hurt. And by the time he got there, her body drops down into the elevator shaft, and you see her, but her jaw is not with her.
Oh no!
Yeah. She gets killed here.
Yeah,
or she can. She can get killed
here. Yeah. Yeah.
She is super dead.
Oh.
And that was terrifying, but I saved her this playthrough.
In all of our games, she was okay, except for having been flung down an elevator shaft.
Mike decides to, I think he might see somebody walking away, and he follows this person out of the mines to, like, he comes upon, like, an old asylum. So, at this point, like, let's go ahead and cut over to Josh and Chris and Ashley, and they're playing with a quote-unquote spirit board.
Well, Chris does a prank on Josh and Sam in the basement where he pretends to be like, he puts on one of the old costumes because Josh's dad is a Hollywood producer, so there's all this stuff in the basement.
Mm-hmm.
And this basement is like, it looks like the basement to my high school. Like, it's immense
it's impossibly
boiler.
Huge.
Yeah. And you also see a baseball bat, which you can like move upstairs or take down with you.
Baseball bat, if you choose to move it, can be made available for use later.
Ooh.
But if you choose to put it back where you found it, it is not able to be used.
Mm-hmm.
But they go down into the basement to turn the boiler on. They get scared by Chris, who's wearing like a monk robe. And he hilariously tells him they got monked.
And that's how you know he's the funny one. Mm-hmm,
that's creative.
He's like the third funniest one, though. I think both Sam and Ashley are actually funny and likable, and Chris is awful.
Yeah. And so this actor who plays Chris is Noah Fleiss, who's in one of my favorite movies called Brick, which was like Ryan Johnson, the guy who directed the last Star Wars movie.
Yeah.
It was like his first feature film.
Is that the one about a school shooting?
No, it's like a crime noir that's set in a high school, like a modern day high school, but everybody, all the characters talk like they're in an old timey noir movie.
Oh, interesting.
It's a really good movie starring Joseph Gordon-Levitt.
Oh.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, it's good. He plays the muscle, the serious muscle guy.
I wish they got a better funny guy, because I find he's not very funny.
Yeah, he's a good actor in this other stuff that he's been in, but yeah, not great in this.
Yeah. And so yeah, you bring up the Ouija board, and things get interesting here.
Yeah, you start receiving messages from Josh. You think it's Josh's sisters?
Mm-hmm.
And I don't remember what happens. Oh, the board seemingly like flies off the table.
Yeah. It's Josh, Chris, and
Ashley
doing this. And yeah, it says like, who are you? It's Hannah. Someone killed me. And she's a ghost. And the ghost tells you to go to the library.
Oh, yeah. So you go to the library and like a bunch of books fly off the shelf.
Mm-hmm.
And behind the books is a button. And you press the button and it opens up like a secret stairway to like the basement.
It's to like a secret area where you find like a postcard with bloody writing on it that looks crazy. That's just like 16 years. I've been waiting for your beautiful girls.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And that's creepy.
Yeah.
Yep.
And yeah, so back to Sam is having a bath. Did you notice in the cable car room that the camera, the first time you go to the cable car room, there's the security office and the camera's on the bathtub for like a split second?
Mm-mm. No.
Yeah. The camera's on the bathtub, which comes back later.
It does.
Mm-hmm.
So what happens now? Because I feel like we get to Chris's choice between Ashley and Josh like right now. That's what happens right now, right?
Yeah.
So they're making their way through the secret area and they both get knocked out by this crazy guy wearing overalls and like a Halloween mask.
Yeah.
And then Chris wakes up and he's in this room and he goes and he looks through the window and both Josh and Ashley are tied up.
Mm-hmm.
And there's a big spinning blade that's going towards them. And Chris has to make the choice as to whether he's going to kill Josh or Ashley.
There's a psycho Saw style talking to them too. Saying
yes,
like,
it's very Saw-esque.
And this is a cabin. It's a separate cabin outside of the lodge. You have to walk a little ways. And on the way, you can find like a butchered pig and stuff.
Oh, yeah.
And a spooky like scarecrow that pops up for no reason.
Mm-hmm.
That was kind of weird.
We should explain. Okay, so in between chapters, there are these little interludes there's like an anonymous person talking to a psychiatrist played by Peter Stormare. He gives you all these little things to do. Like he shows you some pictures and you have to tell him how they make you feel.
Mm-hmm.
Or like he asks you what scares you and you can pick like spiders or gore or
snakes. Clowns.
Yeah. And I think the thing that pops up here, the scarecrow, pops up if you choose scarecrow and the things that scare you.
No,
I chose scarecrow because I love Jonathan Crane, the Batman villain, the scarecrow.
I said clowns. Oh, maybe it had a clown mask on. It might have had a clown mask on for me. Yes, it did, because I said that clowns scare me.
Oh.
Yeah, because clowns do scare me, and so does the dark. And Peter Stormare, the psychologist, makes fun of you for being scared of the dark.
I was very happy to see Peter Stormare. I like Peter Stormare and everything.
He looks like a weird robot, Peter Stormare. It's very... His character in particular, I find the most weird looking, because I think it's the closest to him, maybe? Like,
yeah,
it's
a real Uncanny Valley situation.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And every time you go back to the... every chapter you go back there, and it looks a little worse for wear every time you...
Yeah.
Yeah, it looks a little more decrepit. I like that... So I chose gore as the thing, one of the things that scared
me. Yeah, me too.
And I went... When it cuts back to the psychiatrist after, like, chapter 3, there's, like, a big pile of entrails sitting on the desk.
Yep.
It's aversion therapy.
So what scares you, Vanessa, according to this game?
Scarecrows.
Oh.
Hmm.
spooky, wooky, strawy scarecrows.
Oh.
Look out for them crowy scares.
Is there a scarecrow in his office later?
I don't remember.
When I did it, there's a clown in his office.
There must have been, yeah, I guess there was a scarecrow silhouette or something.
Yeah.
They don't actually scare me, so it didn't really make a good impression.
Has either of you played the game called Silent Hill Shattered Memories?
That's the one for the Wii, right?
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Do you remember that it had the exact same gimmick?
It did, yeah.
Like, in between every chapter, you're doing another section of this basically, you're, like, telling this to a psychologist, and then, like, things that you say might have happen in the game. Like, you predict what's going to happen. You sort of choose what, like, a house looks like and what people look like, and
yeah,
you answer a lot of questions, and it changes the game.
That's one of the best, that's probably the second best Silent Hill game, I think.
It's really good.
It is. It's really good. Anyways...
We're dancing around this huge event.
We are.
And it's time to just get to it.
So who did you guys kill?
Jigsaw situation. We haven't even set up what exactly is happening.
Mm.
So Ashley and Josh are behind the glass. Both of them are tied up. There is a spinning circular saw going sort of at them. And then there's two tracks that the saw can go on. And there's some kind of recording, I think, that says like... You have to choose one of these tracks or a voice or something like that. And you can save either Ashley or Josh. Well, actually, you direct it to one of them. So you kill either Ashley or Josh.
And the thing is, you first say who you're going to save. And I thought that I was going to say sorry to Josh. But then I accidentally said I'm saving Josh. But then I didn't save Josh. And Josh is like, what the hell? And yeah, you see that saw blade go through him. And I think maybe because I said I don't like gore, there's lots of like organs and stuff going on there.
Yeah, there's lots of guts flying around.
It was gory for me too.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
I tried to save neither of them. Mm-hmm. I was like, I'm not going to do it. And then it just went on the Josh track.
Okay.
Yeah. So the game cuts from here back to Mike, who's wandering around this asylum following this mystery man around. I don't know what he's doing here. What is he trying to accomplish?
Now, he's trying to, I think, track down who it is because he thinks this person hurt Jess, right? Like grabbed her
through. Yeah.
And he's got a gun, but the asylum. Also, I didn't take a shot at the guy leaving the mine because I wasn't sure this was the same guy who attacked her. I was like, I don't know. He doesn't seem...
That's very responsible of you, John.
Mm-hmm.
There seems to be a lot going on here. And there is, like, notices by the RCMP about a convict on this mountain. And that seems to have something to do with the weird postcard, too.
Yeah.
And so I went inside. He's, like, got these wolves that he's tamed. And he's, like, feeding as he goes inside.
Mm-hmm.
And I found a secret way in on the side that he, like, walks around and seems to, like, really make you highlight and pay attention to.
Yeah.
And did some climbing and got in there and then had to find a key card. This was all very Resident Evil-like, and I loved it. I loved it. Because you find bodies and spooky, scary traps. There's a waving hand attached to a device.
And if you touch it, he gets his fingers caught in a bear trap.
Can you skip it? Can you not touch it?
You can. You can skip that totally.
Oh, okay. I did touch it, and I did get my fingers caught in a bear trap.
So did you choose to, like, disarm the bear trap, or did you choose to cut your fingers off?
I cut my fingers off.
I cut my fingers off, too.
Yeah.
Me, too.
They say that's the way to go, because if you use the machete to open the bear trap, the machete is no longer usable.
Well, do you need it?
I think you use it later in the game.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, you can.
Yeah. So, but if you choose to cut your fingers off, then you still get to use the machete.
And if you choose neither, you have a working hand and a machete, right?
Yeah.
If you don't touch that obvious trap that I was still dumb enough to touch.
With the dismembered hand waving at you.
Yeah.
So he doesn't find the mystery guy, but he does make it into his little chamber.
I did make friends with a wolf.
Yep. So you get cornered by a wolf and you can either choose to like hit it with mm-hmm. your machete or leave it alone. If you leave it alone, it warms up to you.
I kicked it away. I didn't hit it with a machete, but then I went and got some food and gave it to him.
You can do that. So you can hit it and then win it back over, or you can hit it a couple times and it will always be hostile towards you, I think.
Oh, interesting.
And this wolf shows back up later, so be nice to the wolf because it helps you out later.
There's also some stuff about the miners you find out here, like that there was, I think, 18 people in the mine or 30 people. Yeah, there's 30 people in the mine. Only 12 came back. Yeah. They seemed pretty healthy, but something's wrong and they start killing other inmates. And they were rescued from this mine collapse. 12 of them were stuck in this penitentiary afterwards because something was wrong with them.
Yeah, and so as you move throughout the game, there are 3 different sets of clues you can find. There are clues that relate to the twins' disappearance.
Mm-hmm.
There are clues that relate to what happened in the asylum in like 1952.
Mm-hmm.
And then there are clues that relate to the identity of this mystery man.
He likes cigars.
He does like cigars.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And that's a major clue. Mm-hmm.
Is it?
No.
Oh.
And so Mike eventually makes it out of the mines. Or not the mines, the asylum.
The asylum.
And the game cuts back to Sam. Sam is in the bath. She's naked.
Ooh.
And it shows the psycho guy that's knocked Chris and Ashley out and made Chris choose who to kill. It shows him standing behind Ashley in a very spooky way.
Mm-hmm.
And then she gets out of the bath and finds her clothes gone, hilariously.
Mm-hmm.
Hilarious.
And so she has to, she's kind of like walking around this house in a
assuming
towel.
It's a prank.
Yeah, like yelling people's names. Very funny, guys. You stole my clothes. Blah, blah, blah. And then she goes to the basement where she is like attacked by the psycho guy.
Mm-hmm.
And you can run away from him successfully. Mm-hmm. Or you can make some wrong decisions, hit him with a baseball bat, and still get away.
Or
he captures you, I think.
I got captured.
I got captured.
Oh, see, I made it away, and I hid successfully.
Lucky.
Oh, wow. Good for you.
What happens if you get captured?
He puts a gas mask on you, and that's as far as I got with Sam's plot, so I don't know.
He knocks you out, and then eventually... some of your friends come along.
Yes, I remember. I think you're playing as Chris here.
Yeah.
And
he sticks a little sharp object through a air vent into the room that Sam's in, and he cuts her loose.
Oh, interesting.
So like if you get away, you make your way to, you're trying to find Ashley, and as Chris, you make your way through this like basement, like a labyrinth, and you come into this little room and you find like a dummy that's wearing Sam's clothes. And you turn it around and it's just a plain dummy that you thought was Sam, but it's not. And then eventually Sam catches up to Chris here.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Oh, so I missed a whole chunker.
Mm-hmm.
Aw.
And so there's another kind of Saw style game that happens. Chris comes upon Ashley, who's tied to a chair,
mm-hmm.
and he's told to sit down at this table, and there's a loaded gun in front of him, and there are saw blades that are like dropping down from the ceiling that are going to cut into them both. Mm-hmm. And he's told that he can either kill himself or Ashley in order mm-hmm. to save one of them.
Right.
Ooh.
And I think, again, I refused to make a choice, mm-hmm. and he just, like, starts screaming and firing randomly into the air.
Yeah, he tries to shoot at the saw blades, and nothing happens, and then the saw, like, comes down right over their heads, and then it cuts back to Sam. And so Sam makes her way through, and comes upon this scene, and right as the saw blades get down to their heads, they stop.
Mm-hmm.
Oh.
And then the psycho guy comes out in the overalls,
mm-hmm.
mm-hmm. and takes his Chris tries to shoot him. He takes the gun and shoots at the psycho guy, but the gun is full of blanks.
Yeah. Oh.
And then he takes his mask off, and it's Josh.
What a hilarious prank.
Yeah, and at this point, it becomes clear. You can find some clues that allude to Josh, like, having some a lot of mental health problems.
Yeah.
And Josh takes his mask off, and he's obviously, like crazy.
Could you have killed Ashley in the thing before then?
No, it goes to Josh anyway.
Yeah, if you select Ashley. Yeah. But I think Ashley then gets mad at you.
She does. Yeah.
Well, that makes sense.
It affects a pivotal decision later in the game.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. So everybody's really pissed at Josh.
He doesn't understand. Yeah, he did this as a good prank to get his friend Chris to finally admit his feelings for Ashley and get them together.
Are you serious?
Yeah. And then at this point, Mike also shows up.
Mm-hmm.
And they decide that Josh is dangerous. So Mike thinks it was also Josh that took Jessica from the guest cabin.
Right.
And so he gets pissed at him and knocks him out. And they take him to the barn and tie him up in the barn.
Okay.
And punch him.
And punch him. They punch him a bunch of times. And then the game now cuts to Emily and Matt. Finally, mm-hmm. back to Emily and Matt.
See, yes, this is favorite I skipped that whole thing and just went to Emily and Matt after Sam got gassed.
Oh, yeah. Interesting.
And so Emily and Matt are tasked with, going to find help because they somehow learn that things went bad at the lodge.
Mm-hmm.
And
Chris tells them because he runs into both of them on the way back. And crazy shack.
And so they're like, we're out of here.
Yeah. And so they go back to the what do you call it? Something car? The lift car?
The cable car.
Cable car, yeah. And they find that it's missing a key.
Mm-hmm.
But they see on a map that there's a fire tower close by.
It's also been ransacked. And
it has been ransacked and trashed and lots of crazy stuff painted all over it.
And someone there, it's the psycho, so I guess it was Josh was watching Sam and all that.
Yeah, he had the whole house rigged up with cameras. Because as you're playing as Chris, when you're going to find Ashley, you find a couple of the cameras.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Okay, that makes sense.
And so they locate a fire tower, and so they go to find the radio in the fire tower, and they climb up it, and what do you know? Somebody sabotages it, and it starts to fall over.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, because they did make contact with the ranger station. They said they're going to send a helicopter, but we had to wait.
Until dawn.
The titular until dawn.
And the ranger station, I guess, is held up by a very important cable that...
One cable.
since I had this axe and Matt leaves it behind on the way up because Matt makes dumb decisions.
He always... he does. So he makes two of the most terrible decisions in this game. He leaves the axe at the bottom of the ladder, and then as you're at the top of the fire tower, you can look around as Emily and find a flare gun.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And you can choose to either keep the flare gun or give it to Matt to hold on to.
I was not giving that to Matt.
If you choose to give it to Matt, he immediately fires it. And it does nothing.
He's like, I'm going to get help.
Yeah, so don't give it to Matt. Hold on to it because you can use it later.
You have to give it to Matt, or
no? You can choose to keep it or give it to Matt.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, I kept it, and then I thought that's what got Matt killed for me.
No, so you can.
Well, we'll talk about this.
Yeah. So the tower collapses, and then playing as Matt, you can choose.
They also get cornered by a bunch of moose, elk.
Oh yeah, that's before they find the fire tower.
And that was a really cool scene, and I think you can use the axe to get through, or you can be nice to the animals. And I think depending on whether you shot the squirrel, this is different.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
Emily is terrible, so she's always like, just kill them with your axe.
I was nice.
There's a mechanic in this game that is never explained where you have to be nice to animals.
Yep.
And so if you're nice to the elk, then they won't force you off the cliff and kill you.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. There's one death totem I got here. I don't know what it's relating to, but it just shows Matt with his face blown off and just his eyeballs. It is really weird.
Oh yeah. He can get, I think that happens in the mine later.
Okay. Well, I'll tell you how Matt, this is where I finished the game. So the radio tower falls. Here's what happened with me. The radio tower falls. M barely avoids getting killed by a fax machine.
Yeah.
And the tower falls into a mine. M is now dangling precariously off the tower. And I try to get to her and I can't because it's like collapsing. And she's like, I keep getting the option to jump to safety, but I don't. I'm like, no, I'm going to do it. I'm going to save M. And she's yelling at me. Like, she's still mad at me about not siding with her in the argument with Jessica, which wasn't good. And then she just falls to who knows where. So Matt is on his own and is walking through the mine and then suddenly gets grabbed and dragged, and there's nothing, I don't have a flare gun, so there's nothing I can do. I gave it to M. And whoever's in this mine lifts Matt up, puts him onto a meat hook through the jaw that breaks his teeth.
Oh, no.
And his mouth fills up with blood and he drowns.
Oh, Matt.
Oh, that's gnarly.
It was real gross.
If you want to save Matt, you can choose to... If you choose to jump to safety before helping Emily, you jump to safety and the mine collapses and she falls down the shaft and then it just kind of cuts away.
So how does he get the gun?
He does not get the gun. He never gets the gun.
Okay.
Well, at least not ideally. But so she keeps the flare. She doesn't die.
Oh, okay.
So she falls down the shaft and it eventually you get to play as her again.
Hmm.
Okay. Oh, interesting.
Yeah. So, let's see. What's going on with the other characters? So, Josh is tied up in the barn. What happens to the rest of them? I'm trying to remember.
I don't know.
They're just, like, hanging out. I guess... this is when Flamethrower Guy comes.
No, that's later. Because so the game cuts to Emily. So the game cuts.
Yeah, Emily's in the mine.
Yeah, so the game cuts to Emily in the mine, and she's like trying to make her way through to get back to the surface.
Yeah, and she can find Beth's head down there.
So as Emily, you make your way through the mines, and you come upon Beth's body. And when you go to touch it, her head falls off, which is pretty funny. In fact, if you, I streamed like the latter half of this game on Twitch.
Yeah,
I was looking through my Twitch highlights last night, and this scene where I discover her head is one of my Twitch highlights.
Nice.
But you find her body, and her head is there, and it's really gross and creepy. And then you go to make your way through the rest of the mine, and you find yourself like being attacked by something.
Mm-hmm.
And the flamethrower guy, the creepy guy that Josh was following earlier, like eventually helps you.
Yeah, he saves her.
Yeah, so the flare gun that you have is used as she's running out of the mine and she's almost to safety. I think if you make one mistake, you use the flare gun to save yourself. You shoot the monster that's chasing her with a flare gun.
Mm-hmm.
But eventually you make your way out of the mine with the assistance of this crazy backwoods man with a flamethrower played by like B horror movie icon Larry Fessenden.
Okay.
From what?
He's in he's been in a bunch of stuff. Let me look it up on IMDb here. The most recent movie I saw him in was a movie called We Are Still Here. Mm-hmm. Which was a horror movie with Barbara Crampton.
Okay.
But he was in, let's see. Let's go all the way back.
It's gotta be something I've seen.
Yeah. He's got a huge filmography. Let's see if I can find. He was in Bringing Out the Dead.
I haven't seen that.
He was in the movie Session 9.
Oh, I've seen that.
He was in, let's see, We Are Still Here. He was in Broken Flowers. Okay. He was in,
that's a good movie.
Let's see, what else is here? Cabin Fever 2.
Oh.
He was in Stakeland. He did the narration in the movie Southbound, which was a horror anthology that came out last year.
All right. Let's move on.
Yeah, he's been in a lot of stuff.
Larry's famous. Let's go.
Larry Fessenden, everybody.
Yeah. So then he goes back with her to the cabin, right?
Yeah, well, she gets there first, and mm-hmm. he eventually shows up and just, like, drops some exposition on everybody.
Yeah.
Ooh, and okay, tell, like, me. I'm so excited to find out what,
like,
happens.
Listen here, you young teens. I'm a protector of this mountain, and what you got here is a Wendigo infestation.
What?
Now, what's a Wendigo, you may be asking? Well, a Wendigo is a human who are possessed by evil spirits after consuming human flesh and giving in to the instinct of cannibalism.
What?
Now, what's a Wendigo like, you may ask? Well, a Wendigo is big and strong and sort of shaped like a human, but it ain't human no more because it gave in to the terrible instinct of consuming human flesh.
Yeah, got
How
it.
Do you kill a Wendigo? Well, you better not, because if you kill a Wendigo, you release the spirit of the Wendigo, and then another Wendigo will be made eventually. But what you can do if you really have to is burn it to death, which is why I carry a flamethrower.
Mm-hmm.
So what was his beef with the Washingtons?
So he did not want the Washingtons on the mountain because because the mountain is cursed.
When people are around on this mountain, they give in to their instinct for cannibalism and become a Wendigo.
And the reason why he's in the asylum, so you alluded to earlier the 12 miners that had something wrong with them.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Those miners resorted to cannibalism in the mine.
They were trapped in the mine and they resorted to cannibalism.
And
that's when Wendigo. They were possessed
they
by the spirit of the Wendigo.
And most of those Wendigos are still locked up in the asylum. You find as Mike later.
Oh, and he doesn't want to kill them because that releases the spirits.
Yeah, he
that
does.
That would release the spirit of the Wendigo.
He does kill a number of Wendigos, though.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
So here's what happens. So Larry Fessenden, the flamethrower guy, shows up, and he's like, everybody needs to hunker down in the basement until dawn because the Wendigos only hunt at night. So you go to do that, and everyone's like, no, we have to get Josh. We left him in the barn. And he's like, no, your friend Josh is already dead.
And they're like, you don't know that. Josh is a really good prankster. He probably pranked those Wendigos and got out of whatever plan they had for him.
So Chris and Flamethrower Guy go to get Josh. They make it to the barn, and they find that he's already been taken.
Oh, no.
They
call up Liam Neeson, and they're like, hey, our friend Josh has been taken.
And he calls the Wendigos. But no, so they find that they're being hunted by the Wendigo now that they're in the barn. So you have to, like, carefully, you go to make your way back to the lodge, and the thing with the Wendigo is they're like T-Rexes. So if you don't
let
move,
let me tell
they
you about a
you.
Wendigo. If you don't move, it can't see ya.
So,
but you don't want to be close enough to a Wendigo that's your only resort.
So they find themselves close enough to a Wendigo where that's their only resort, and
that's got the controller mechanic where you have to, like, hold the controller still, right?
Yes.
Very still. Or put it on a coffee table.
Yeah,
no.
That's what I did. And but no matter what you do here, Larry Fessenden gets his head cut off by a Wendigo.
Yeah, aww. Because Chris can't hold still enough.
Yeah. So that happens. Chris runs back And then
he got the shotgun.
Yes, he has the shotgun. And at this point, everybody, well, Mike and Sam decide that they're going to go try to find Emily. And well, everybody decides they're going to go try to find Emily, right?
Well, they want to find Josh because
Emily's already back. They're trying to take the cable car off the mountain, and Josh has a cable car key.
Yeah, so they refuse to bunker down until dawn because even if it become dawn, they don't have the cable car key, so they'd still be stuck there like the next
evening. Were they putting Matt on there for later? Is that why they put him on a meat hook?
Well, that only happens if you get Matt killed.
I know, but that's what I'm saying.
Yeah, yeah, like, that's what they do is they throw him in this pit.
Let me tell you what a Wendigo does. A Wendigo won't kill you right away. A Wendigo takes their prey to their lair and hangs them up. And then the Wendigo eats them organ by organ while they're still alive.
Does he really say that?
That's actually, you read that in his notebook.
So
he leaves like a bag of his stuff in the lodge, and you like rummage through it after he's dead, and you find all of his notes on the Wendigo.
So they all go to the basement except for Mike, who goes to find Josh.
He goes back to the asylum
too. Sam stays there, but first before Mike leaves, Emily reveals that she has been bitten by the Wendigo.
Is that a thing?
Well, I mean, it's true that she's been bitten by it.
Yeah, she gets bitten as she's trying to escape from the mines earlier. Mm-hmm. And when
but
she makes
they're
it back...
They're not zombies.
Well, when she makes it back to the lodge, she reveals that she's been bitten, and there's a really tense scene where Mike wants to shoot her.
Yeah, it's quite a debate. Ashley and Mike want to kill her.
Okay.
Sam does not want her to be killed. Chris, I think, is kind of neutral.
Yeah, he doesn't say anything this entire scene.
Yeah. So you get to play as Mike, and you pick up the gun, and there's like the little target on Emily, and she's like, "Don't shoot me! Don't shoot me!" So did you kill her, Jim?
I did not kill her.
Nor did I.
It's actually pretty funny if after you choose to kill her or not. Ashley wanders over and picks up the flamethrower guy's journal, and the first page that she flips to says, "A bite has no effect."
Yeah. And then as Ashley, you can choose to like reveal that or not.
Yeah.
Why would she want Emily dead?
She thinks she's going to turn into a Wendigo.
Oh, okay.
The bite of a Wendigo causes no ill effects beyond that of an ordinary bite. So then Sam reads something in the journal that makes her think that she needs to chase after Mike.
What was that?
I'm not really clear.
I don't remember either. But so, and then Ashley decides to go too.
I don't think Ashley goes too at this point.
Well, she does because that's how I got her killed.
Well, they go later.
Oh,
so
okay.
First it's just like Sam going after Mike. Mike goes through the sanatorium again. This is where he reunites with Doggo. Mm-hmm.
Doggo!
And he discovers all of the Wendigos that are locked up in their cages.
Oh.
Mm-hmm.
But not all of them, because there's a Wendigo on the loose.
Yeah, there's a couple of them.
Yep.
And so you can choose to run away and blast them. You can shoot at some exploding barrels and kill like two or three of them.
Mm-hmm. But if you make a mistake, at some point Doggo can lose his only one life because dogs do not have nine.
Aww.
And he becomes Deado.
But you can save Doggy?
You can. I did not. I think, Jim, I was watching your stream, and I think Doggo died because you didn't barricade a door behind you.
Yeah.
And for me, I missed a quick time event, so a Wendigo jumped on me, and then Doggo jumped on the Wendigo, and they got him.
Mm-hmm. Hard to keep the dog alive here.
Mm-hmm.
So Mike makes his way out of the sanatorium, and it's on fire because you shoot a bunch of barrels. Mm-hmm. And then he meets up with them in the cave, right?
Yeah. He meets up with Sam. The other guys decide that they're going to move for some reason.
Wait, who?
Like, Chris and Ashley and Emily decide that they're going to go somewhere else. Oh, I guess they do go with Sam.
Yeah, they do go with Sam. Yeah, there. So there was Sam, and you play as Ashley here. And this is where I had my first character death. Because one thing you learn about the Wendigos, too, is that they can perfectly imitate their prey.
Mm-hmm.
Oh.
So I was playing as Ashley.
It says so right in the book.
It does. I was playing...
Like moments before this happens.
I was playing as Ashley, and you're following everybody through the caves, and I hear, like, a voice that I thought was Jessica's voice.
Oh, yeah. We had a little... If Jessica survived, we get a little cutscene right before this chapter of her, like, waking up in the mines.
Yeah.
Oh,
and
okay.
So I thought I heard her voice, so I walked to this little side thing, and I saw this trap door in the floor, like, rattling. And so I opened it, and immediately got attacked by a Wendigo that pulled my head off.
I think that's... I saw that as a danger totem.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, probably.
It is one of the danger totems, and it also says right in the book, but I'm not going to keep harping on that.
I was really bummed that this happened, and I blamed it on Stan, because he was watching my stream.
I do love Ashley. She seems fun.
Yeah.
Although, she seems like she lost her head.
Yeah.
Oh! Nice. So as Ashley, I think you're with Ashley and Mike at this point. You make your way through the cave, and eventually mm-hmm. you do find Josh, who is tripping out now.
Oh, yeah. We get like a little moment of playing as Josh. He wakes up in a cave and he's like super freaking out and just yelling at nobody in particular.
Oh.
He like hallucinates a giant fleshy womb on the wall that gives birth to a giant pig head.
Or a scarecrow.
Oh, or was it a scarecrow for you?
I think so, something like that.
Oh, mine was a giant and his bloody pig head.
Yeah, and he hallucinates his sisters, and they're like, why did you want us dead? And he's like, I didn't.
Yeah,
they're
like ghosts.
Yeah.
But eventually they find Josh, and he's, you know, they snap him out of it long enough to, like, get him part of the way through the cave back to the house, but he eventually gets abducted again by the Wendigos.
Yeah, the Wendigo, this particular Wendigo, we're shown at this point has a... butterfly tattoo on its arm.
Oh, no. It's Hannah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, and then you find Hannah's journal that says, Beth is dead. I've been here for a month. I'm going to die. I'm sorry, Beth. And it's implied that she, like, eats her.
What happened here is she gave in to her instinct for cannibalism.
No.
And that's what made her become a Wendigo. and then like the last page of her journal is like, I'm not hungry anymore. I'm getting stronger.
Yeah, I'm
super cool.
So hungry.
And
itchy, tasty, itchy. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So, so she takes Josh away again.
Mm-hmm.
There was some discussion at some point of like, does a Wendigo retain its like human memories or something? And they're like, I don't know, maybe. That's a mystery of the Wendigo.
I'm the ghost of Larry.
So they all go back to the house, and everything's fine.
Well, no, so they all separately kind of make it back to the house, and there's, I think Sam is the last one to get there. She makes it into the room, and what do you know, a Wendigo, like two Wendigos come in from the ceiling.
Is it Hannah Wendigo?
It's Hannah. Hannah is one of the Wendigos, and there's like two or three other ones.
Okay.
Yeah. And they fight. Everyone is staying completely still. And the Wendigos start to fight each other like they're like feral animals. Mm-hmm. And one of the Wendigos throws one of the other Wendigos into the fireplace. And it it disconnects the gas line, so there's gas pouring into the room. And so both Mike and Sam look at a light fixture on the wall and think, we gotta blow this sucker up. So this part of the game is like all don't move the controller because you don't want to be seen by the Wendigos.
Yes, and this is the only place I lost a character.
I also lost a character here as well. So if you don't, the goal is to either stay still long enough for the Wendigos to distract themselves and then for everyone one by one to make their way out the front door, or to distract the Wendigos successfully so that people can make their way out the front door.
Both valid strategies?
Well, you can either do one or the other, or like one mixture of both, I think.
Okay.
In my case, Mike was about to be killed, and then Ashley, who's at the door, like distracts the Wendigo away from him, but then runs outside. And I think that was because they had a good relationship. Like, he had stood up for her at some point.
See, I got Mike killed because I didn't stay still enough twice. So I moved the controller once, and they picked him up and threw him on the floor, but he got up. And then I moved again, and they picked him up and threw him against a pillar, and his like back broke, and he died.
Ow.
So I managed to save him, but then in one of the very last Don't Move Sam... quick times, I moved Sam, she gets picked up by her good pal Beth, and ripped apart.
Her good pal Hannah.
Yeah, I'm sorry.
And so, depending on who makes it out, eventually they do, like, blow the house up.
They do.
And the game kind of ends with a shot of the burning lodge and like a helicopter flying over it, a rescue helicopter.
Now, whenever you kill one of the Wendigos, you get sort of a face in flame coming at the camera, being all like...
Yeah, like a shitty 3D effect.
Yeah.
And then as over the end credits is like almost like a talking head of each of the surviving characters as they're being interviewed by the police. And then it kind of talks like, the characters have regrets about how they treated each other. They'll talk about choices that they made in the game.
Yeah. If Mike and Emily are both alive, Emily will be like, did Mike ask about me? Like, did Matt ask about me? He loves me.
Yeah. And then Sam, has survivor's guilt. She says it's all her fault that she died, or that, whoever died.
Yeah. Sam was not there for me, but I did have a moment where they were interviewing Jessica, and they were like, oh, Ashley says that she heard you in the mine, and Jessica's like, no, that wasn't me.
See, I had Jessica survive and Mike die, and she's like, where's Mike? Did he make it out? And I was like, aw. If you don't make the right decisions with Josh, he can die. He can be killed by the Wendigo. But if you have him survive, which I think the only way to have him survive is to find the last twin clues at the end. Hannah's journal, I think. But if you don't find Hannah's journal and Hannah's necklace, then he dies. But if you find them, then the Wendigo like keeps him alive because the Wendigo remembers him. And in the epilogue, since the Wendigo died and he's down in this pit, it shows the police like coming up on the mine, and they find Josh, and he's like eating a dead body, and he's like half a Wendigo already, and he attacks the police.
Happens there is Josh, trapped in the cave, gave in to his instinct for cannibalism.
So, but is there a way, does Josh always turn into a Wendigo, or is that just one of the...
That is his ending if he survives.
Yeah.
He's
either dead to go or Wendigo.
Yep. Why didn't he get rescued by the cops?
Because he was stuck stuck in the mine pit.
Okay.
They went down there to get him. But he had already given in to his instinct for cannibalism.
I see.
And that is the end of the game.
Can I ask a few questions that I have?
Yeah.
Who cut down the ranger station?
That would have been the Wendigo.
The Wendigos are capable of doing such things? They have some intelligence? Okay.
Maybe they just tripped over it.
Yeah.
So did Josh make the books fly and the Ouija board move?
Yeah. You find some of the clues that you find are like schematics for traps that he built. There's a chapter in the game where Chris and Ashley are walking through these hallways in the basement and you keep seeing a ghost. And it shows like his special effects rig for how he makes the ghost.
Oh, so he probably was the one who set up the clown trap and the mask trap.
Yeah, he did.
I think he probably is.
Okay. Okay.
So
that makes sense.
You guys thought that he had not prepared for his friends to come, but he had been preparing for a long time.
He didn't prepare in any practical or accommodating way.
No.
He definitely was not trying to comfort them to death.
No. And, you know, he claims, you know, to be doing this to bring them together, but there's also an element of revenge where he blames them all for his sister's death.
What's the ending about, or how does the stuff wrap up with the psychologist or psychiatrist?
So eventually you learn that the psychologist is just all in. So Josh is actually the person sitting in the psychiatrist chair.
Yeah.
And the doctor is just like, it's all just like a hallucination that's going on in his mind.
Oh, yeah, okay.
He probably was Josh's psychologist at some point.
Yeah, as Sam, you can find Josh's cell phone, and it's got a bunch of text messages from that doctor that say, like, I haven't heard from you. I know you're not taking your meds. You need to call me. This is an emergency, blah, blah, blah.
Yeah.
Okay.
But the psychologist just ends up kind of admonishing him a lot.
Yeah, for treating his friends like shit.
Yeah, he's like, what's wrong with you?
Oh, so by the way, guys, the reason why Larry Fessenden in this game is interesting is because he starred in a horror movie, a B-horror movie called Wendigo, that came out in, like, 2001.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. So here's my thought about this game.
Mm-hmm.
I liked it a lot.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think it needed the Wendigo.
You know, I feel like it should have chosen the Wendigo or the Saw stuff.
Yeah,
even if the Saw
the
stuff
Wendigo
was fake.
Or the like friend prank that then ends up going wrong. Maybe even like another additional psycho. Perhaps from their group.
Right. I would have. So I'm not a fan of the whole Saw aesthetic. I hate it. And so I'm glad they didn't commit to that. I wish they would have gone full slasher. Like a real, like, I know what you did last summer vibe.
Yeah.
That's what I was hoping for.
Like if it was just like Hannah the whole time?
Yes, that would have been great.
Do you ever find out what the Washingtons did to make the First Nations people of Alberta angry?
So that's actually, you kind of learn that all the clues that you find about that were planted by Josh.
Oh.
Yeah.
Okay.
Josh needed a scapegoat, and he chose Indian burial ground.
Yeah, Josh was trying to make you think that there was, like, a psycho guy who was inhabiting the mountain who was upset on behalf of the indigenous people.
But there kind of is, except he's a Wendigo hunter. He's the guy who went to jail for arson, right?
Yeah, because he was burning the Wendigos.
Yeah, if you find in his journal that his family has been like hunting Wendigos for a while, and a Wendigo, the strongest Wendigo, killed his dad, and he hunted and killed that Wendigo.
Mm-hmm.
Oh.
He's a real supernatural.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, that's the end of our story.
Mm-hmm.
So what was the end? Like, so when he faked his own death, did he like use pig entrails or something?
Yeah, yes. I think you find a receipt for like a pig.
You also find like a gut. You find his workshop and it's got like all the CCTV cameras and stuff. And in one corner is like a gutted pig.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Makes sense.
Yeah.
All right. So what's your favorite spooky game?
this one.
Really?
I mean, it's pretty good.
Yeah, it is. I wish if it there was a way to like tone down the jump scares, I think I'd have really, really liked it. I just found it so anxiety inducing to play. Although now that I know what happens, I think I'll find it less scary, so I might be able to get through.
Yeah,
it.
And I think that Sam and Mike always survive to the last chapter.
Right.
Regardless of what you do, as does Josh. So, you know, it takes away from some of that fear factor if you know, like, okay, these like two main protagonists are going to be okay to the very end regardless.
Hmm. Yeah.
I do like monster stuff and exploring old mines and exploring old haunted castles and stuff. So that part of the game I loved for sure.
Yeah, I think the sanitarium parts were the best parts of the game.
Yeah. All right, but I think we should probably wrap up. Are you?
Yeah.
Is this game an instant classic?
Oh.
I think it is. I think it's unique, and I think it's one of the... It's like the only game I can think of that balances so many characters and narratives that well.
Yeah, I mean, it plays on classic horror tropes, and there's nothing really new for the genre except the delivery method. But it's a unique game. It's very special. So yeah, I'd say it's an instant classic.
And I'm too scared to finish it.
Oh, which maybe is the most glowing review of all, because it's supposed to be scary.
The first night I played it, I told you folks this, I had a nightmare about it. And I didn't, that was only after like chapter two.
I'm normally really scared by these games too, but I actually playing it on Twitch and streaming it, you know, because you're kind of narrating it as you play, it really eases a lot of the tension.
Yeah, so does Jim's particular narration style of, first of all, correcting any swears that the characters make. So if someone says hell, Jim will then say...
H-E double hockey sticks.
Or damn becomes darn, you know. He's very concerned about their language. Mm-hmm. And he also has a special song for walking up or downstairs.
Yeah, I like to do a doot. Like as to them walking up and down the stairs.
All right. Well, thank you very much for supporting our spooky Patreon.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And we'll come back next month with some kind of versus episode. We haven't decided what yet, but maybe we'll put up a poll or something.
Yeah. And if you missed Jim's Twitches, you can go to our Facebook page and just do a little search for Twitch, and there's a comment thread in there with the link to Jim's Twitch, and you can, I guess, watch the videos. Is that how it works?
Yeah, it holds videos for 2 weeks.
Yeah. Okay. And I'm gonna be, yeah, you can find my streams of Until Dawn. I've also been streaming other horror games as I decide to sample them. I did one stream of The Evil Within, and that game's, I don't really know if I like it, but I'm having a lot of fun playing Alien Isolation right now, so check that out.
Me too. It's got Phoebe, mm-hmm. and Phoebe it's alien. Got Handsome Jumpsuit Man.
Mm-hmm. And Scott Bot.
Scott Bot.
I think Scott Bot is, no, Scott Bot is not Handsome
no,
Jumpsuit Man.
No, Handsome Jumpsuit Man is someone else.
Okay.
Yeah. Unless you like older, bald Scottish men.
No.
All right. Goodbye, everybody.
Goodbye, everybody. Bye.